assess what that is. And we should hold that as the objective. And we should learn from all these different streams of thought and understanding, from the permaculture perspective, and the biodynamics, and the organics, and the conventional, and everything else. Those things that we can learn to help us achieve that quality. So that is really the formal objective for me in the course, is to produce high quality crops. As a farmer, I have grown many crops that were infested with pests and diseases, which I, in totally good faith, sold and ate. And at this point in time, I can feel very embarrassed about that. I understand that nature is speaking, even though I may not be listening. And when she says, this is food for insects, what she means to say is, it's not food for animals. And she says, this is food for bacteria or fungi, what she means to say is, this is not food for animals. And that's a sort of a deeper sort of, I'm not sure what the right word is, conversation that I have with myself about if I have pests in my garden or if I have diseases, you know, is it ethical for me to sell those crops or is it appropriate to try to kill them? So anyway, there's a larger conversation here about nutrition, about flavor, about health-giving attribute, about you know, soil carbon sequestration, about agribusiness, about the pharmaceutical industry, about consciousness, about politics. It's for me, it's really, really exciting because in my 20s, I was much more of an overt activist, sort of rah-rah, you know, the 9/11 truth activist and working for Dennis Kucinich, and you know, I was like GMO, you know, out there doing GMO stuff. I think what I've come to is that this topic of food quality, of nutrition, of flavor, of aroma, vitality in nature, actually is something that we can work toward as opposed to something we can fight against. And it's something that we're all trying to work for, really, work toward, really. And so if we can create a space where we're safely, comfortably, honestly discussing it and working towards it, perhaps we can coordinate this movement towards, you know, transformation that we're all aching for. So there's some very broad and megalomaniacal or extreme points, perhaps. But it's really it does connect for me all the way down from the soil all the way up to the whole culture and the environment. So what we're talking about really is what does life need to function, and how can we best create the environment where life has what she needs to function. And if we can do that, then you can step back, and that's when you get the efficiency. That's when you get the leverage of low input, low effort, high output, is when life is actually doing the work. I use the metaphor of the Grand Banks. Anybody heard, you know, where the Grand Banks are? Off of, you know, the Bay of, Gulf of Maine. Anyone know about this? No. Some people know about this. Grand Banks. All the fishermen between Newfoundland and New Jersey take their boats and drive them and park them in the same spot. You know what this? All the fishermen from New Jersey to Newfoundland, they all take their boats and they all drive and they park in the same spot to go fishing. Does anybody know why?
That's where the fish are.
That's where the fish are. So why are all the fish there?
Because the rest have been wiped out, I guess, or overfish.
Somebody said something over here.
It's where the food is.
It's where the food is. It's where the food for the fish is. And why is the food for the fish there? Because all the environmental conditions are correct. Because you've got the warmth, and you've got the minerals, and you've got the sunlight, and you've got all the environmental conditions necessary for the phytoplankton to reproduce en masse. And then you have the bottom of the food chain is flourishing, and then so the rest of the food chain can flourish. And so for me, it's about that with life. If we understand that we're really building the food chain, and we're trying to build the life in the soil, that's really what we're trying to do. When you do that well, it's life that does all the work for you. Right? Plants should grow by themselves. If you look at nature, nature grows plants by herself without much work. You have to create the environment where those plants will grow by themselves. And if you can modulate that with your understanding and sensitivity, then you can really stand back and life will do the job for you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Nothing too revolutionary there, except for the fact that it's revolutionary. I'll just draw a little picture here because this helps me understand this. Some of you may have seen this picture before, if you've seen me present. I almost always use it. This is a stick figure plant, somewhat recognizable, perhaps. We know that in most plants, there are leaves of various shapes or sizes. Most of those leaves are green. What goes on in the green of a leaf?
Photosynthesis.
Photosynthesis, here it is right here. CO2 plus H2O plus sunlight equals sugar and oxygen. Photosynthesis. In a healthy plant, in nature, two-thirds of the sugar is taken from the leaf, I got various colors, and dropped down through the root, through the stem to the root, and injected into the soil. Two-thirds of the sugar that a plant makes in nature, in a healthy plant, is injected into the soil. That's what healthy plants do. And this is sort of the scientific window into understanding how nature works, which can support our deeper intuitive process. why do healthy plants do this?
To feed the organisms in the soil.
To feed the soil life, to feed the bacteria and the fungi. So this is where the food for the bottom of the food chain comes from. The bacteria and the fungi get fed by plants. Every green leaf you see is designed to feed bacteria and fungi. One could argue by the bacteria and fungi because they were here first, and you could argue they evolved the plants, but that's a whole different conversation. So there's this area that surrounds the root zone. It's called the rhizosphere. It's not just this simple, right? Because plants' roots are much more fractal in nature. And then you've got, of course, the mycorrhizal fungi, which are expanding the plant's root surface by 900,000% on average. So, in direct relationship to the plant root is where the vast preponderance of life in the soil resides. That's where the grand banks are. The grand banks are in direct relationship to the plant roots. Only healthy plants, those plants which are feeding the soil life. Why are they feeding the soil life?
Because the soil life is feeding them.
Because that's how they evolved to be fed. Because the plant can't exude the acids and bases necessary to solubilize copper out of the soil or to solubilize phosphorus out of the soil. Plants can't do that. Bacteria and fungi can. They can't make sugar. The plant can't solubilize the soil. So the plants make the sugar to feed the soil life so they can be fed, so they can reproduce, so they can complete their life cycle. And when they're fed, when the plant says, I need phosphorus, guess who it feeds? The phosphorus solubilizers. And when the plant says, I need copper, guess who it feeds? The copper solubilizer. So the plant has evolved this understanding to feed different compounds into the soil that feed different species, like feeding your cows or feeding your chickens, when it needs different things, like milk or like eggs. Right? This is how the plant has evolved. This is a, you know, hundreds of millions of years old process. This is how nature seems to have designed the system, to the best of our understanding scientifically. So, but this only happens when you have plants that aren't being fed fertilizer. If a plant's being fed fertilizer, I don't care if it's organic or not, if it's soluble, if it's got a number, if it's 5-3-4 or 10-10-10 or 0-5-2-0 or whatever the numbers are, that, what does the number mean? Number means soluble. Soluble means the plant doesn't have to feed anybody to get it. Soluble means it's like a Gatorade. When the plant takes up its water, it can't help but take up those nutrients also. Right? The extreme version of this would be an IV drip. Right? An IV drip goes directly into your bloodstream, gives your body the nutrients it needs, and totally short circuits the gut. So from my understanding, this is the gut of the plant. This is the gut flora of the plant. And people know about colostrum. You know about when an animal's born, a mammal's born. The first thing that comes out of the mother's breast is not milk, but colostrum is evolved to establish gut flora. That's foundational because when you're born, you have nobody living between your mouth and your rear end. The whole alimentary canal has nobody in it. And you can't digest your food, only they can. So it's critical that at birth that gets established. So for me, this is also critical at birth of the plant that that gets established. Which, you know, will segue into the question about inoculation, which we'll probably talk about after lunch. But conceptually here, this is how plants evolved. And the more fertilizer you feed them, the more soluble nutrients you feed them from birth on, the less you give them their, you know, sauerkraut and kimchi and, you know, yogurt, the less able they will be to feed themselves when you put them out into the garden. How's that? So this is, foundationally, this is biological systems. I think we understand this about ourselves, we understand this about our animals. This is, seems to me, exactly how it works for plants as well. So, in Ayurveda, the sort of medical science of the, you know, the tantras and the ancient Indian tradition, it's all about the gut. It's all about the gut flora. I'm not sure what it's like in Japan or China. I don't know what their medicines are. But, you know, I look to the East for affirmation. It's about the gut flora of the plant. For me, it's about the bottom of the food chain, the phytoplankton in the ocean. You know, when we build high levels of vitality and vigor in the bottom of the food chain, then the rest of the food chain naturally flourishes.
So yes. Is this why, because I used to work on a ranch long ago, and they put so much fertilizer out, had no soil biology. The soil was just dead. Because the microbes are gone then, right?
Because the plant's not feeding the microbes.
Right. So that symbiotic relationship gets
short-circuited
out.
And when you put a bunch of fertilizer down on your plant, bone meal and blood meal and stuff like that, you know, chicken manure that's soluble N, soluble P, soluble K, the plant uses those up, and then when it gets hungry, what does it do? It's screwed. And they crash. And they start to starve. You guys up for visceral metaphors yet, or is it too early in the morning?
Good.
Ready for the visceral metaphors? All right.
So you think once a plant is given this, it's not able to do it from that point forward, even if in the past it has done it. So say when it was growing as a seedling, it wasn't giving even any fertilizer. But once in the field, if it is given fertilizer once, it will be unable to do that.
Not necessarily. But what are you starting it with in your potting soil? What's your potting soil? Is your potting soil soluble in NPK? Or do you put inoculants? I mean, some people use this thing called sterile media. Have you ever heard of this sterile media? Have you seen a bag of potting soil that says sterile media?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We promise you it's dead. That's what that means. We've killed everything in here. We think bacteria and fungi are bad. It's probably got soluble salt fertilizer in there. So, I mean, for me, we'll talk about potting soil later today and then tomorrow morning as well. That's really, really important because that's the early chapter development stage. It's not categorical black and white, but in general, what you want to do for your plant is you want to, you know, bring it up well with good food, good nutrition, and train it to, you know, interact sustainably with its environment and then create those environments. So I'm going to talk about all the logistical details about how to do it. I want to just sort of lay the groundwork here, and for some people for whom this is a new concept, drive it home, perhaps a bit emphatically, because I think it's important. Yes?
So are you saying that soluble minerals or nutrients are generally, you shouldn't use them?
I don't like black and whites.
Yeah.
I think NPK, nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, which is the sum total of the fertility conversation about 98% of the time, we should be minimizing solubility. Solubility is part of the conversation. We're going to talk about that when we talk about pH. Certainly, if you're getting things like copper or zinc or boron, you know, in forms that are readily available, they're going to be somewhat soluble, but you can modulate that and make them less so. Generally, you don't want things to be soluble. You would like things to be complex.
Right.
In terms of an organic compound. That is the ideal situation.
Right.
But you can put your fingers on the scale to move things around. This is, I mean, I think what Western civilization has done to this continent in the last 500 years is pretty atrocious.
Yeah.
And, you know, do we want to take 500 years to build it back up? Or do we want to use our combined intuition and understanding to, you know, rapidly facilitate, you know, increased vigor and vitality?
Right.
I mean, things like seawater is an example. I think in small quantities are extremely valuable.
Right.
Which is totally soluble.
And that's a lot of soluble.
Which is totally soluble.
Right.
But it's all about the nuance about how you do it and how much you do and stuff like that. So not categorical black and white, but in general, soluble NPK fertilizer is something that would suggest you nuance yourself. If you've got mycorrhizal fungi in your soil, if you've been minimizing tillage, if you've got a good fungal community, those guys are extremely sophisticated at solubilizing phosphorus. Your UVM or UMass soil test might say you have no phosphorus, by which they mean there's no phosphorus available, soluble. But if you've got a good fungal community in your soil, they are extremely good at feeding your plants phosphorus. Potassium, there's, you know, 20,000 pounds of potassium in every acre of soil in the top 6 inches. Easy. But when you let your soil dry out, all that potassium adheres to the soil colloid and is unavailable. So bare soil, you know, dry soil is anathema to soluble potassium. You don't need to add potassium as long as you keep your soil moist as it should be, because if you don't have moisture, then soil life can't live also. Nitrogen, two-thirds of every breath of air you breathe is nitrogen. Two-thirds of every breath of air you breathe is nitrogen. Every single tree in nature grows just fine with no nitrogen fertilizer. Every plant has evolved the capacity to, with bacteria and fungi, take nitrogen out of the atmosphere as it needs it, when it needs it, and cycle it. So we don't need really, I mean, maybe your soil is low in phosphorus, so you should add some rock phosphate. But soluble phosphorus, soluble potassium, soluble nitrogen, as a rule, I think we can dramatically minimize when we have a more well-functioning living system.
Things like rock phosphate are not soluble in a soluble
form. Rock phosphate is an example. Is 20% phosphorus. And if you look at the bag, it'll say 030.
Okay.
You're dropping my chalk. Because only 3 of those 20 pounds are soluble.
Right.
And it's illegal to write this is 20% phosphorus on the bag, because the laws have been written by the fertilizer companies to make it so that things that are soluble seem more valuable.
Right.
So the farmers don't really know, and they say, well, this one says 030, this one says, you know, 010. Like, I'm going to buy that one because it's got more phosphorus. No, it doesn't. It's got more soluble phosphorus, which is actually bad for your soil fungi. Mm-hmm. What you really want is this one over here, which is a rock. But you've got to understand what you're doing first. Small tangent, first of many. maybe not yet the first, maybe so the second or third already. If you look at agriculture as it's, you know, practiced in general, with tillage and with one crop, you can look back in history to about 10,000 years ago, at least that's the story they're told, right? Mesopotamia, Tigris and Euphrates River Valley, beginning of agriculture, end of the last ice age. We think about the Egyptian civilization in the Nile River Valley. We think about the ancient Indian civilization in the Indus and the Ganges, the Chinese and the Yellow River Valley. Right? We have these concepts about the ancient cultures that were in the same spot for thousands of years. Not the ones that were there for a few hundred years up and then crashed, but the ones in the same spot holding on for thousands of years. And they seem to be in river valleys. Which to me is interesting. And I think there's an insight here, and that is that when you are taking thousands of pounds of crop off of an acre every year, a lot of that is air and water, but some of it is actually minerals from the soil. And if you do that, and what the plants are doing when they make their seeds, their fruits, whatever it is they're making, is they're bioaccumulating the most valuable ingredients from the soil for their seeds for next generation. And if you take those off, not 5, 10, 20, 50 years, but 200, 500, 1,000, 2,000 years in a row, and you're tilling the soil, which is destroying structure, which is facilitating leaching, What happens through agriculture is that the soil ends up getting worn out. Right? The soil ends up not having in it anymore those foundational things which life needs to flourish. So that's what I really want to be talking about here this morning before lunch is the remineralization aspect. There's a few different components to maintaining life in the soil as far as I'm concerned, but I really want to be able to be having you guys all comfortable with reading the soil test, making recommendations, understanding where you can source different kinds of materials, how you apply them, all that kind of stuff by lunch. That's sort of, you know, piece one of this puzzle. But before we go into that, what does this life in the soil need to exist? What are the foundational components? I think it's on the bottom of slide 2 or 3. Just want to cheat.
Yeah, water.
Actually, just figure it out. Water. Without water, life doesn't function. I like to say, if you can't maintain hydration, don't waste your money on minerals. Mm. Right? You could spend $500,000 on minerals and not have the capacity to keep moisture in your soil. And I'm not sure what your guys' summer was like, but for us, we had about 6 weeks with no water. Water's really important. Yes. The life cycle of a bacteria was 2 hours. How many days does your soil have to be dry for mass genocide to have occurred?
Wow, I didn't know that. 2 hours? Is there
bacterial?
Like... Yeah, I didn't know that.
An hour and a half, 4 hours. Yeah.
And so can it go into a hibernation stage, any of the bacteria or the fungi, can they go into a...
They can go into sporulation,
yeah.
They can go into suspended animation,
so they
but they're no longer feeding the plant.
Yeah, good.
Anybody ever seen this happen when it gets hot and dry out for a week or 10 days in July, and the plants that used to have nice green shiny leaves like the summer squash, all of a sudden they get not so shiny anymore?
Yeah.
You seen that happen?
Of course.
And then when they get not so shiny anymore, for a little while, then they start to get so not so green anymore, and then they get to not all green, but some yellow and some brown, or some holes, and then they get to be dead. Right? What's that shiny green? What's the shine?
Fat.
Fat. That's oil. That's what do you do when you've got extra nutrition? What does a cat do or a cow do when it's got more food than it needs?
Stores.
It stockpiles extra energy in the form of fat. What does a plant do when it's being fed well? It stockpiles this extra energy in the form of fat. What does that look like? It looks like a shiny leaf. What are you seeing when you see that shine go off of the leaf?
Consuming and starving.
You're seeing a cow that hasn't been fed for a week. It's starving. Because the people that feed it, the soil life, are all dead. Because the soil's dry. Anybody ever seen that?
Sure.
Every year. Just about. Every single year. If you don't have water, you're, yeah, SOL. So water's really important. What else?
Oxygen.
Air. Poof. These guys are really big. Air and water. It gets down to brass tacks here. What's one of the major modes by which farmers maintain aeration in their soil?
Tillage.
Tillage. Right? When your soil's hard and compact and tight in the spring, if you don't loosen it up, your plants aren't going to grow. You can say, I'm going to do no tillage, and you put your plants in, and they don't do very well. Because you have not created the environment where the soil is loose and open and has air in it. So for me, this, again, a foundational practice, what are some of the best practices? You know, for me, it's earthworms. You know, if you can create an environment where earthworms are flourishing, you can pretty much not have to till. And they don't really need much. They like the soil to be moist. They like there to be some kind of a cover. Whether it's cover crops or mulch in the wintertime. This is like really, really important. And if you can do nothing else when you go home after this workshop, get your hands on some leaves or some straw or some mulch hay, I don't care what, and get a good 4-6 inches down anywhere you can see soil. Because I guarantee that area will be loose and friable and full of earthworm castings in the spring, where the area that's where you can see soil now will be tight and hard and need to be tilled. I think it's 20 earthworms per square yard will till your soil 8 times in a year. I don't know what the numbers are. Something ridiculous. 40,000 pounds of earthworm castings per acre. Wow. Anybody ever bought earthworm castings?
I used to make them.
Anybody ever apply compost?
Yeah.
40,000 pounds per acre for free, evenly distributed, without any effort, by maintaining an environment where earthworms are flourishing. It's ridiculous. It's totally ridiculous. And for me, cover crops and mulch are foundational, plus water, and you do have to put the minerals in. If you don't have the cobalt and the copper and the boron, then the biological systems don't function. The bacteria, the fungi, and the protozoa, and all those guys that are the, you know, bottom of the food chain aren't there, and the earthworms aren't flourishing as well as they otherwise would. But yeah.
When you say earthworms till the soil, they're not actually inverting it.
They're eating it down here. They're drilling through. They're eating it. They're pooping it up here. They're moving it up and down. They're dragging things down. They're doing something.
But that doesn't harm the fungal growth.
My understanding is actually they. I mean, you know what? Earthworms, they chew their cud, and then they spit it out, and the leaves that they chew up, it's like a crotchety chicken and a cow. An earthworm is a crotchety chicken and a cow. There's more calcium coming out their butt than there is coming in their mouth. Like a chicken, they violate basic laws of chemistry all day long. unless you understand things from a whole other level. They're ridiculous. And I know they're not indigenous, but they're pretty much here for for a while. So
I've heard that they're bad for forests, but I don't know.
Because they are so busy digesting the duff.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. They're not indigenous. They used to be 3-4 feet of, you know, litter in the forest floors when white man came. The earthworms have eaten it all up.
Wow.
Anyway, for better or for worse, they're valuable in facilitating loose soil in the garden.
Mm-hmm.
But they do, I mean, when we bought our farm, it was a really hard, tight, like you could take a shovel and jump on it and, you know, get an inch and a half in. And, you know, 2 years later, it was this like total, dark, crumbly ridiculousness full of earthworms. Before, there was like occasional, like little short one,
mm-hmm.
but nothing. It was light colored. You maintain moisture, you get organic matter in there, keep the soil covered. I have found it to be not difficult to maintain a high level of looseness in the soil. But it is very important. There's an air, yes, foundationally important. These guys can only breathe as far down as there is air. So what's the easy way to tell if you've got sufficient air in your soil or how far down the air goes? Stick your hand in. How far down can you reach your hand? You don't have to have anybody there checking. You don't have to buy any machinery. Just go and look and see how loose actually is the soil before it starts to get really tight underneath your fingernails. Inch and a half, 4 inches, 8 inches. I know some places have rocks, so rocks don't count. You can go around rocks. That's foundational. Air is foundational. And tillage, if your soil is too tight, is necessary. But if you establish a good management set of management practices, you can rapidly evolve away from it. I certainly have a rototiller. I certainly use it. I use it very infrequently, and when I do, I use it very shallowly to prepare a seedbed. That's my basic system right now. Air and water.
So mulch seems key in the earthworm thing, right?
Cover crops or mulch.
Because I do a lot of salad greens,
yeah.
And I can't. You obviously can't mulch.
I do a ton of salad greens.
You do what?
A ton of salad greens.
Okay, so
that's why I make my fair amounts of money.
So what are your strategies? I mean, do salad greens like deter earthworms because you're not mulching or
no? They're
like,
great.
What?
The soil's covered. I mean, green
right.
cover is better than brown.
Yeah. Okay.
Bare soil is what you're trying to be. What you're striving to not have.
Okay.
I like to say if I can see my soil less than 2 weeks of the year, then I've had a successful year growing annuals.
Right.
I broadcast my salad green seeds. I take my handful of seeds and I walk up the row and I go like this. And I broadcast them onto a seedbed that I've, you know, tilled 4 to 5 minutes ago.
Yeah.
And between 2 and 3 days later, they're up. And
you're able to distribute the seeds well enough that they're not like too clumped together or...
I grew up on a farm. There's a few tricks I've
done. Because I use an Earthway seeder,
oh,
which is very time consuming.
They're ridiculous. You got to prepare the soil to like this total powder,
right,
and then
right.
tighten it before you can use the thing.
Right.
And it costs money, it takes forever, and you don't know if the seeds went down.
Right.
You got to wait days, and then
okay.
just take the seeds and Goes real fast.
Yeah.
Do you not cover the seeds lightly?
I have a bad habit of not covering.
Yeah.
I try to cover, I mean to cover, but I have too many things going on oftentimes, and if I get the seeds planted, I feel pretty proud of myself. Yeah.
They come up fine.
And they come up fine. I made $1,000 on Thursday.